Jay Show here on BritAsia TV. We are going to be talking to one of the most exciting people on the internet, but he's coming up a bit later on.
He certainly is. Now, though, we're delighted to introduce you to someone who initially was known as a DJ, but right now he does a lot more than that. It's all about the debate. It is Nihal! Yay!
Seat.
Oh, he's going to come and give me a kiss. Hello.
You're all right.
I'm good, thank you.
Amazing. I like it how you just walked slowly, just taking more claps. Give him a bit more of a clap, dude. Come on.
Yeah.
He was waiting for that. The guy in the back who was heckling about, you know, getting jealous on how much, you know, lady love this man's getting, on Twitter, he's hating right now.
Straight hate.
Yeah.
Now, Nihal, for a lot of us, we've supported you throughout the years that you were on Radio 1, and what a fantastic period of time to be on Radio 1. What was it like for you to be one of the first Asian DJs playing Asian beats on the biggest national radio station in the country?
Well, it was... it was amazing because, of course, we were there at that time that Jay Sean and Rishi and Juggy all came through, and Raghav as well was there. And it was one of those things where you just felt like you were part of something. I remember going to Glastonbury for the first time with Rishi, Juggy and Jay, and we got into two of us. It was quite an adventure. And we started off in Southall, and it was like Beatlemania. There were just kids running after. No one knew who I was. They just thought I was the Sri Lankan tour manager. And there were all these people chasing after it, banging on the windows, trying to get autographs with Jay and Juggy and Rishi. And then, of course, because we were all a bit London and we weren't really involved in that whole festival thing, Juggy, I remember having white trainers on. You know, Jay was wearing, you know, box fresh crepes. Everyone was looking good. But, of course, for those of you been to has anyone been to Glastonbury in this crowd?
Yes.
Okay.
Oh,
yeah. Okay.
You
got must be a white person who just because brothers and sisters don't
camp. Do that. Yeah.
We just don't do mud. Like we're brown enough as it is. We don't want mud anywhere near us.
Exactly.
Right?
Exactly.
So we turn up and suddenly we're all looking at each other going, "There's mud! There's mud everywhere!" And we look at our feet. So then what we do is we all get carrier bags and tie them to our feet and walk through Glastonbury looking like
genius.
The worst tourists ever.
Now,
like
these carrier bags, what shop provided you with those carrier bags? Just out of curiosity.
Well, this is a commercial TV, so we can't say that.
Oh, okay, fair enough.
And I've got my BBC head on. But of course, for me, it would be Harrods or Fortnum & Mason because I swag like that. I swag like that, you know. I think Rishi had Lidl or something on his feet. No disrespect. And we turned up there. And then we did what we had to do. And then we got back in. And then we broke down on the way back. Mm-hmm. So it was like me, Rish, Juggy on the side of a motorway. Then this guy came, fixed it, but then didn't fix it. And then it was essentially, we left London at midday on the Saturday. And we got home at 1 p.m. on the Sunday. And none of us had slept. And that was our first experience. And that whole period, it's a shame really, because that whole period from like 2003 when Punjabi MC came out and was, you know, and Jay-Z jumped on Mundi Antar Bachke, and then Jay and Rishi and Juggy and Raghav, and these guys were on Top of the Pops, and if you're old enough, you'll remember this music show called Top of the Pops. It was all massive, and then of course it just kind of disappeared. It really did just kind of disappear, and no one really came through, and we don't... Well, I've analysed it many times as to why that was, but it's such an exciting time because for the first time, young British Asians, now people who are in their early 20s here, they would have been in their early teens.
Yeah. Exactly.
And they were going mad for this because for the first time ever, you were seeing Asian artists, British Asian artists on mainstream TV shows being interviewed and their videos shown on MTV. And that was a first, and it was exciting to be a part of that.
And now your show...
Is the short answer.
Yeah, your show on Radio 1, I don't know why they've stopped it, but they have stopped it.
Yeah,
right?
After
12 years, and nothing's replaced
Can we have a round of applause for that, please?
12 years.
12 years on Radio 1.
And I listened to your first ever show. I remember where I was. I was in Brixton, and it was like stupid o'clock in the morning, but we're so proud that we were hearing Punjabi music.
Morning,
I remember that.
Yeah.
And we heard your last one as well.
Yeah.
And it was quite emotional, to be honest with you. Do you think that that was the right way for them to go, to just stop something like that? Because it wasn't just Asian music you played. You played Asian beats.
Yeah. I think that you don't have a right to have a Radio 1 show just because you're brown.
No, right. I agree.
The music has to justify it, and ultimately, there isn't much of an Asian music scene. Right. That's the problem. You know, in order for you to be on Radio 1, there has to be Asian artists regularly in the charts, like you see with Afro-Caribbean or African artists. Tiny Temper, Dizzy Rascal, yeah. Fuse ODG. You see Melissa Steele, you'll see kind of British black artists regularly, Rech 3-2, in the charts. But you're not seeing that with Asian artists. Now, Bhangra has its place, but Bhangra is never going to cross over. It's not in English. You know, Steve driving down the M1, he's not going to be like in his van going, I'm on the Antabachkai. He doesn't get it, he doesn't understand it. And I'm Sri Lankan, I don't understand Punjabi. The only Punjabi I understand is to do with drinking, girls, and swearing. Yeah. Pretty much the only things I've ever been taught in Punjabi. And
you don't really need to know anything else.
No, to be fair.
This coming from him.
And also, as well, there's a lot of things about it, and I'm going to get kind of deep here. You know, the Asian scene is such that, you know, the club scene's dead. And the club scene's dead is because the clubs let too many guys in. Mm. The guys don't know how to chat to women, so they disrespect women in the club, so the women don't want to go to the clubs. Asian guys have got a problem with drinks, so they fight too much in the clubs. And if all those things happen, you've got nothing. You've got nothing to do. Whereas, you know, you go to a rave, like my own wife will say, she'll go to a mainstream club and she won't get felt up, but she'll go to an Asian club and some guy will grope her.
Right. Mm.
And I hear that from a lot of people. That isn't just a one-off.
The thing is that you can talk about this because on your show on BBC Asia Network, you talk about these kinds of subjects regularly and people do phone in and express themselves like so. And this is where you moved into now. You've gone into discussion radio. You've been on the BBC World Service. You
Five comment Live, on Radio Five Live. Four,
So your career is still, you know, very much on the rise.
Well, what my thing was that, you know, once you get married and you have kids, do I really want to be in a club, you know, getting in at 4 or 5 o'clock in the morning? I still love music and I'm still very well connected into the mainstream music industry because I came through the music industry. Before I got to Radio 1, I was working with Elton John and I worked with Lionel Richie and I worked with rappers like, well, loads of rappers. You know, I wrote for hip-hop magazines. I was a journalist, so I've interviewed everyone from Snoop Dogg to... I've done it, all of that stuff. I just didn't want to really be a DJ anymore. I love music, but I didn't really want to be involved in clubs. And I made that decision to join the Asian Network because actually I'm very interested in the Asian community and how they think and their voice.
And you do strike debate, don't you? It's not just one person's opinion. You really give the opportunity for everyone to air their opinion, no matter what we feel is PC or not.
Yeah, and I've got a lot of hate on that over the years. You know,
you have.
I think in any given month, on Twitter, someone will say, I'm anti-Hindu, I'm anti-Muslim, I'm anti-Sikh, I'm anti... And the fact is that I'll ask questions. I'm not going to just let you tell me that something is true because you think it's true. You know, there is a difference between opinion and fact, and some people get that twisted.
Yeah.
They think opinions and facts are the same thing, and they're not. I'm here to challenge you. I'm not here to be anti-anything. I'm here to challenge you. And people often say, oh, you twisted their words. I didn't twist your words. I just repeated what you said.
Exactly.
And when I repeat it, you don't like how it sounds.
Exactly.
Because actually, you weren't listening to what you were saying.
What time are you on Asian Network?
10 a.m. to 1 p.m., 5 days a week, multi-award winning show.
And
not because of us. Not because of us. Not because of me, but because we talk about things. We talk about deep things. If we're going to talk about abuse in the Asian community, sexual abuse, physical abuse, if we're going to talk about alcoholism, if we're going to talk about drugs, if we're going to talk about caste discrimination, if we're going to talk about religious hatred between religious communities, you know, these are sensitive subjects. You know, the guy who runs Radio 2 and runs the Asian Network once said to me, you present the hardest phone-in show across the BBC. Nothing's more difficult because when you're talking about those issues, people have sensitivities. Like this week, for instance, we were discussing, why is it that if a woman is having her time of the month, she can't walk into a religious building, certain religious buildings? She can walk in, but she's not allowed to pray, for instance, in a mosque or in a Hindu temple, for instance. Someone called in and said there are signs up that say, ladies, if it is, then please don't touch the altar, don't come in. And we were asking that question, well, why?
Right.
You know, and some people don't want us to ask that question because they just want to accept what goes on. But my thing is that you can't just accept some because someone tells you it. You have to question. And most religions, in fact, all religions I know, actually encourage questioning. Yeah. They encourage you to have knowledge. Sikhism is about being a student, right?
So when the channel itself, your
Islam's
show,
the same.
It does that. It gives everyone the opportunity to have their say.
Yeah.
And then let off. Through and let off to a certain degree.
I know I made it all deep in here.
But the thing is, as deep as this man is, but he's also a rapper. Did you know?
Back in the days. Sonny and I wanted to do was talk about those topics because we don't shy away from those here on British TV or on the Sonny and Shay Show because it's really important to talk about them. But the one side that people won't know, I know Nitin's smiling because he probably will, won't know about Nihal is actually, there's the other side to him. There's a funnier side that we get to see, not a lot of the audience ever gets to hear.
Yeah.
So back when, we won't say 10, 15 or 20 years ago, we'll leave that up to everyone to decide. You once were a rapper. So I wanted to choose something that I love. And I want to see if you...
Can rap it.
Well, not rap it, or at least guess what the rap is. But I'm not going to rap it, because I'm not a rapper.
No, you just read out the words. I'm sure you'll get it.
I whistled for a cab, and when it came near, the license plate said...
Fresh Prince.
And it had a dice in the mirror. If anything, I could say that this cab was rare. But I thought, no, forget it. Yo, Holmes, to Bel Air. What goes next?
Oh, yo, Holmes, to Bel Air.
We're off.
Do you know what? I don't know the Fresh Prince rap.
I know West Philadelphia,
born and raised, is that how it begins.
Yes.
But that's how it begins. You've gone further on into the rap, haven't you?
I pulled up to the house about 7 or 8.
Home, smell you later. One of those. I say, home, smell you later.
And when I came there,
something, and then I became the Fresh Prince of Bel Air.
Hey! We're going to try and get the housing a bit more rapping. Plus, we're going to be talking a little bit of the corner shop. We'll be back straight after the break.
Thank you.